Now let's see what happens in a typical parallel program. In a typical parallel program that you might write, you probably get a lock, and you have mentally an association between that lock and the data structures that are governed by that lock. Or in other words, in writing your parallel program, you decided that access to variables A and B are governed by this lock. So if I wanted to read or write variables A and B, I'll get a lock, and then I will mess with the variables that are governed by this lock. Once I'm done with whatever I want to do with these shared variables, I'll unlock, indicating that I'm done. And this is my critical section. So within the critical section, I'm allowed to do whatever I want on these data structures that are governed by this particular lock, because that is an association I, as the programmer, has made in writing my parallel program. So if another processor, let's say P2, gets the same lock, it's going to get the lock only after I release it. So only after I release the lock, this guy can get this lock, because the semantics of the lock, it is a mutually exclusive lock, and therefore only one person can have the lock at a time. And consequently, if you look at the structure of this critical section for P2, it gets a lock and it is messing with the same set of data structures that I was messing with over here. But by design, we know that either P1 or P2 can be messing with this data structure at any point of time. And that's the guarantee that I know comes from the fact that I designed the parallel program and this lock is associated with these data structures. So in other words, P2 is not going to access any of the data that is inside this critical section until P1 releases the lock. We know this because we designed the program, but the SC memory model does not know about the association between these data structures and this lock. And in particular, it doesn't even know that memory accesses emanating from the processor due to this lock primitive is a different animal compared to the memory accesses coming from the processor as a result of accessing normal data structures. So the cache coherence mechanism that is provided by the system for implementing the memory consistency model is going to be doing more work than it needs to do, because it's going to be taking actions on every one of these accesses, even though the coherence actions are not warranted for these guys until I release the lock. So what that means is that there's going to be more overhead for maintaining the coherence commensurate with the SC memory model, which means it's going to lead to a poorer scalability of the shared memory system. So in this particular example, since P2 is not going to access any of these data structures until P1 has released the lock, there is no need for coherence action for A and B until the lock is actually released.